Alright, this plant is a dandy to know. It's lamb's quarter, and it's easy to recognize by its diamond to almost triangular shaped leaves. Now that one's almost triangular shaped, and this one's more of a diamond shape. It is coarsely toothed along the margins. Alright. On the back, it's dark green on top, lighter green on the bottom, but in the small new growth at the top, it's easy to, what gives it away is the whitish plume that's in there. And what that does is that helps it retain moisture in drier conditions. I mean, if you feel the leaves themselves, they almost feel like they have a waxy texture to them. But in here, it tends to be more concentrated. You can wipe it off, as you see. Wiping it off, turning it green. Unfortunately, the wind's blowing, so it might be a little windy in here. Alright. But especially the young tops. You pick those, and it makes an awesome salad. It's been called, I call it lamb's quarter. Some people call it wild spinach, but it's real high in vitamin C and vitamin D. The stems can be green to having purple stripes in it, as you can see here. Alright. Now the flowers, let me pick one here. The flower heads are green like this, and they grow at the top, coming out of the center here. And this will branch off, forming different little sections, and each top will eventually form a flower head, like this. Now when this thing is completely ripened and all pollinated and everything, what you'll end up with is a series of black seeds. See the little yellow? Let me see if I can get this out a little bit better. The flower heads are going to open up into tiny yellow flowers, which I don't know if you can see them. They are extremely small. But when it's all pollinated and everything, what you end up with, it'll produce a bunch of black seeds. And I mean lots of black seeds. What you can do with those black seeds is grind them down, willow out the shells, and grind it into a black flour, which is real high in protein. Now there is a related species, which is called pigweed. Some people also call this pigweed, but it doesn't have, the whitish plume is not as noticeable, and it's not quite as mild. The Aztecs actually used it as a protein source when the Spanish conquered them. And then the Spanish ended up actually making pigweed illegal to even grow because they were able to get their protein through the seeds, and which made it harder for the Aztecs to control, or the Spanish to control the Aztecs. So, but this is a real good plant to know. It grows anywhere it's disturbed and it's sunny. What you can do is you pick the tops off. You could eat even the older leaves, they're just not quite as good, but you pick the tops off and it'll cause it to branch and it'll produce more, and you have a renewable food source. Alright, that's it for lamb's quarter. I'll see if, because someone had said my videos weren't quite up close enough to see what I was actually looking at. So what I'll do is I'll take a few pictures and see if maybe we can work on that. Alright, thanks for watching. Here's another one. This one here is called Bulrush. And it's kind of like cattails in that it's usable year-round. You can eat the young shoots raw, which we're a little late for that. It's easily identified because of its round stems. I mean, it's completely round. It's not like grass that may start out round at the base, but then comes out and flattens out into a leaf. This is round all the way up, and it produces its flower stalks right out the side of the stem. Alright. Now, you can take the young ones and eat them raw. You can take the older ones, I shouldn't say older, the more mature ones, and pull them up and eat the core at the base. Or use, you know, you can just boil it down, pull out the solids, then reduce that down, and you can end up with a sugar substitute. You can shake the pollen off the flowers, use that like a flour. Then you can also dig up the young roots and do the, you know, the cores, and then the shoots, older shoots, can be used, boiled kind of like a potato. Now the Indians actually used to use these, the bulrush, cut large amounts of them down, bundle them together, and then take those bundles and tie them together into makeshift canoes. They were lightweight. They floated well. Granted, you had to put your feet into the water, no big deal, but it would get you across larger ponds and lakes with no problem. Now, where I'm at, there's patches of them, not enough to make a canoe, that's for sure. But as you notice, see how there's a large clump of them. And this is how they tend to grow. Then you go over here, and you don't see any. But then you'll find another large clump, like that over there. And like that one over there in with the red clover. You know, so this is a fairly readily available plant once you find it and learn how to identify it. Now there's two types. There's hard stem, and then there's great bulrush. And the big difference between the two is the color of the stems and the flower heads. All right, now this is a hard stem. You can tell by the fluffy looking flower. Whereas the great bulrush, the flowers look like miniature cattail heads, the brown portion, not the top male portion, the female portion. But they look like 1/4 to 3/8 inch long, tiny cattail heads. All right, so that one is going to be it for the bulrush. But like I said, you can make, you can actually use the bulrush to make a mattress out of, a fairly comfortable mattress. Like I said, a canoe. There's any number of uses you can do with them outside of eating them. All right, that's it for this one.